Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the King of glory, you have exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. Do not leave us comfortless, but send us your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and exalt us to that place where our Savior Christ has gone before, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, in glory everlasting. Amen.
A reading from the book of Acts. So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom of Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly, two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I ask that you join in the reading of selected verses from the 68th Psalm. Sing to God, sing praises to his name. Exalt him who rides upon the heavens. Yahweh is his name. Rejoice before him. Father of orphans, defender of widows, God in his holy habitation. God gives the solitary a home and brings forth prisoners into freedom. But the rebels shall live in dry places. O God, when you went forth before your people, when you marched through the wilderness, the earth shook and the skies poured down rain at the presence of God, the God of Sinai, at the presence of God, the God of Israel. You sent a gracious rain, O God, upon your inheritance. You refreshed the land when it was weary. Your people found their home in it. In your goodness, O God, you have made provision for the poor. Sing to God, O kingdoms of the earth. Sing praises to the Lord. He rides in the heavens, the ancient heavens. He sends forth his voice, his mighty voice. Ascribe power to God. His majesty is over Israel. His strength is in the skies. How wonderful is God in his holy places, the God of Israel giving strength and power to his people. Blessed be God.
Thank you.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one.
The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If you have ever ridden on a roller coaster, you may remember that particular moment of commitment when, at last, you are at the head of the line and you step off the platform and settle into the seat of the car, and with an ominous click, a locking device firmly secures you in place. And right then, you know that there is no turning back. You are irrevocably situated in the suspense of being taken for a ride, which is all the more accentuated by the fact that no roller coaster begins at its peak. It slowly, laboriously climbs a long expanse of track that appears at first to have no clear point of culmination. And at the top, the track seems to drop away as if to nowhere, which awakens an acute awareness. For you know precisely where you are, and yet you have no idea of what is coming. And you trust that you will safely arrive back at the platform. And yet, how you'll get there and what you'll experience along the way remains utterly mysterious. The suspense consists of this mixture of anticipation and surprise. You know enough, but not nearly everything, which makes the ride thrilling. I'd like to say that a similar kind of suspense arises in romantic relationships. It begins when you take the risk of expressing hopes that you can't be assured will be accepted. Would you like to go out? Will you marry me? And you have no idea what will transpire if the one you ask says yes. You may be bound to a future that you can only then wait upon. And that's a suspense that never comes to an end. It's only ever deepened. For the persons we know best, by sustaining a romance with them over many years, are the very ones who can still surprise us the most, completely, beautifully, unfolding something more about themselves. We have such depth. And thus we wait upon one another, always anew, always expectantly. And this waiting in not knowing makes them far more present to us than to any others. In the text appointed for this morning, there is a fascinating twofold movement. The first tells of Jesus' ascension, which marks his conclusive departure from the world as we experience it. The second consists of Jesus' assurance that he will be eternally present to us. When read together, these texts catch us up within the suspense of placing us in a new position with regard to God's own unfolding and his disclosure of himself to us. Jesus had been locatable, an individual who was easily identified, which was in fact the supreme scandal of his time. It was incomprehensible to those around him that God could be so delimited. It was as a human being, however, that Jesus was uniquely the revelation of God's love to us. For consequently, he suffered the exposure of being vulnerable to our response to him. But it was this very vulnerability that showed the intimacy of his being with us. Jesus, in that intimacy, stands as the one who makes it impossible for us to contemplate God in abstraction, as a mere concept, or as an object that we can coolly examine from a distance, without care, without a sense that something vital and personal is at stake. But he is the one who declared from his own standing as one of us that God is integrally present. He in us and we in him. Yet in ways that we cannot fully predict, such is God's depth. Jesus set us on a new path of looking to God and seeking after God, and living thus in a relationship which, like a romance, never reaches an end or touches bottom. Faith isn't believing a set of teachings. And Jesus didn't merely give us a series of instructions. Faith is setting your life in the mode of suspense with regard to God, in the conscious balance of knowing much and yet not knowing even more. The great challenge of our time is that we have stripped faith of its liveliness by making it merely an expression of religion. And religion now represents little more than a number of identified traditions, learned and followed largely by rote. It's an institutionalized form of complacency, where suspense is quashed, and in its stead, God becomes an idea utterly fixed, who then upholds a series of laws and principles that are equally fixed. And the church is presumed to be simply the deputized judge of our lives according to the standard God has established and revealed, and convention rules. And for all of our talk about God, God seems strangely absent and silent. John, in his gospel, never mentioned religion, nor did he suggest that he was trying to establish a new set of teachings that would be beneficial for us to follow. At the most critical point, what he spoke of, from every possible angle, was glory, which interestingly he never defined. But I would propose this, that glory is that moment in the suspense and the waiting of faith when the word of God to us is yes. When we are surprised by the sudden revelation of God's grace, precisely where we could not have predicted it. And when we discover anew that where we thought God was absent, he is profoundly present. As the one who loves us far beyond the capacity of our imaginations, not as a rule and not even by nature, but he loves us by sheer desire, infinite in its breadth, astounding in its depth. Glory is the radiance of God's romance with us. It's the disruption of our complacency in such a way that all of our future, no matter what is coming, however ambiguous that may be, is still defined by the thrill of promise and the thrill of fulfillment.
I invite you to join me in affirming our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us give thanks to God our Father for all his gifts so freely bestowed upon us. For the beauty and wonder of your creation, in earth and sky and sea. For all that is gracious in the lives of men and women, revealing the image of Christ. For our daily food and drink, our homes and families, and our friends. We thank you, Lord, for minds to think, and hearts to love, and hands to serve, for health and strength to work, and leisure to rest and play, for all valiant seekers of truth, liberty, and justice. We thank you, Lord. Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. We give thanks today for the birth of Oliver Powell Raymond, grandson of Doug and Lisa Raymond. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. We remember before you this day, Linnea, Leo, Gary, Helen Jane, Joan, John, Yvonne, Peter, Riley, Julie, Tony, Jim, Taggart, Stephanie, Dana, and Rebecca. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. We commend to your mercy all who have died, especially Beatrice P. Hompe and Mary Stuart Robbins, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, in you we live and move and have our being. We humbly pray you so to guide and govern us by your Holy Spirit, that in all our cares and occupations of our life, we may not forget you, but may remember that we are ever walking in your sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you, through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Above all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for the truth of his word and the example of his life, for his steadfast obedience by which he overcame temptation, for his dying through which he overcame death, and for his rising to life again, in which we are raised to the life of your kingdom. Grant us the gift of your Spirit, that we may know him and make him known, and through him at all times and in all places may give thanks to you in all things. Amen.
Thank you.
Please join me in saying the prayer of St. Chrysostom. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised that through your beloved Son, that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting. Amen. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. O Judge of the nations, we remember before you with grateful hearts the men and women of our country who in the day of decision ventured much for the liberties we now enjoy. Grant that we may not rest until all the people of this land share the benefits of true freedom and gladly accept its disciplines. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen.